Good morning. My name is Steve. I'm the lead pastor here for those that may not be here every week and don't know that. So welcome. I'd like to welcome you this morning as we gather and kind of get into God's Word together. And yes, we're in the middle of a teaching series, sermon series, if you will. We're called F-bombs, and it's not about that. It's about the fact that there are some words that come straight out of the Bible that if you will allow to drop into your life, Jesus will explode them in your life and explode them in a way that will cause you to have life and life in abundance. And they just all happen to begin with F. And so that is why we're using that as kind of our metaphor for this teaching series. So allow God's Word to drop into our life and explode with His goodness. Now today we're looking at this word. It may be the biggest F-bomb of the Bible of all of them, and this word is forgiveness. This may be the hardest one for us to allow to us to use in our lives and in our language. When we think about the F-bomb and that word that's out there, the F-word, and we'll use things like the F-word or F-bombs because we don't want to say that word. And that really applies to forgiveness. And the reality, even in the church, unfortunately, that we find ourselves in a place where I know we're supposed to, and I know I can kind of say it, but I don't really want to all the time. And maybe I'm the only one that ever feels that way, but I kind of doubt it. And so maybe you're with me, and it can be difficult to forgive. Would you agree that it can be difficult to forgive? Why is that? Just give me some answers real quick. Why is it difficult to forgive? We don't want to admit that we might be wrong. Good. What else? You hurt me. I mean, I think that's really the bottom line, is it can be difficult to forgive because you don't have to forgive something that doesn't matter. Anytime that there's a need for forgiveness, it's because there's some hurt that has happened, that something has happened and it matters to you. And that's why it can be difficult to forgive. And so let's kind of get into this a little bit. The only time you have to forgive is when you're hurt. That's just really the reality of it. And it's difficult for us because it's kind of like we're in relationships. And you think back to the first relationship that's recorded in the Bible, Adam and Eve, the very first marriage. You think about them, and they didn't have a lot to forgive each other for before they ate the apple, or the fruit. It wasn't really an apple, but before they ate the fruit. I mean, think about it. This couple, that she never had to say, like, compare him to all the guys that she used to date. There was nothing to forgive her for. And she never had to forgive him for comparing her to his mother. They never had to have that kind of forgiveness in their relationship. And so even in that relationship, though, eventually, as they went on and they ate the fruit that they weren't supposed to, they had to end up forgiving one another. Forgiveness is so important to Jesus that he talks about it a lot, but today we're going to look at one particular parable, a story that he told about forgiveness. It's found in Matthew 18. Who's got your Bibles? Man, last week when I was in West Monroe, Louisiana, where I grew up, preaching at the homecoming service and then doing this revival, I was there for the week. That was one of my most fun thing for me, was teaching them to say, I got my Bible. And then by the end of the week, they were all bringing their Bibles. That was great. That's why we want you to do it, though, so you'll bring your Bible. If you happen to not have a Bible, grab one from the book rack. And Matthew 18 is in there on page 749, if you're using the book rack Bible, page 749. According to this storyline that Matthew gives, and he's telling one of the accounts of Jesus' life and ministry, Jesus is in this place called Capernaum. And Capernaum is in the Galilee area, which is where Jesus grew up. Nazareth, it was in Galilee, and Jesus was from Galilee. And so this is kind of going back to his home region. And he's there, and he's teaching his disciples. And as he's teaching his disciples, he's teaching them in this area. He's teaching them about the temple tax and about tithing, which he says is important to do. and he sends them out to get fish to bring back a coin so they could pay their temple tax. And he's teaching them about things like humility. And they come and ask, who's the greatest in the kingdom, Jesus? And he teaches them about humility in this setting. He teaches them about God's heart for those who wander, those who are like the prodigal son and the lost sheep. He teaches them these parables about God's love and heart for those who wander. And then he teaches them about dealing with those who have hurt you. And as he's teaching them about dealing with those who have hurt you, Peter, one of his disciples and a close friend, comes to him and he asks this question. And this is how we'll begin our scripture today. Verse 21. Peter came to Jesus and asked, Lord, how often should I forgive someone who sins against me? 7 times? No, not 7 times, Jesus replied, but 70 times 7. Therefore, the kingdom of heaven can be compared to a king who decided to bring his accounts up to date with servants who had borrowed money from him. In the process, one of the debtors was brought in who owed him millions of dollars. He couldn't pay, so his master ordered that he be sold along with his wife, his children, and everything he owned to pay the debt. But the man fell down before his master and begged him, please be patient with me, and I will pay it all. Then his master was filled with pity for him, and he released him and forgave his debt. And when the man left the king, he went to a fellow servant who owed him a few thousand dollars. And he grabbed him by the throat, and he demanded instant payment. His fellow servant fell down before him and begged for a little more time. Be patient with me, and I will pay it, he pleaded. But the creditor wouldn't wait. He had the man arrested and put in prison until the debt could be paid in full. When some of the other servants saw this, they were very upset. They went to the king and told him everything that had happened. Then the king called in the man who had forgiven and said, you evil servant, I forgave you that tremendous debt because you pleaded with me. Shouldn't you have mercy on your fellow servant, just as I had mercy on you? Then the angry king sent the man to prison to be tortured until he could pay the entire debt. That's what my heavenly Father will do to you if you refuse to forgive your brothers and each other from your heart. Pray with me. Lord, this could be one of those difficult teachings. This could be a hard teaching for us. Because we don't want to paint God in any kind of scenario other than this all-loving, all-compassionate God. And you are, because you are love. But Lord, your love doesn't mean you allow us just to get away with stuff. Your love means that you love us like a loving father and a righteous judge. And you hold us accountable. And Lord, for all those sins and all those things that we have, you've forgiven those. You've had mercy on us. You've shown us grace. And Lord, we are so thankful that your amazing love is that kind of love, that you, our King, would die for us. And so, Lord, we confess. A lot of times we hang on to our anger and we live in this place of unforgiveness instead of allowing the forgiveness that you have shown to us. Allow it to not just come to us, but come from us as well. Jesus, you taught your disciples how to forgive. But Lord, they had to be willing to do what you told them to do. And so today, Lord, we come before you and we ask that you would, Holy Spirit, make us willing. Lord, enable us. Because Lord, we want more than anything to honor you. Not just sing a song that says we honor you, but to live our lives in such a way that honors you. And your word shows us, and your Holy Spirit is revealing to us right now, that forgiving others and forgiving ourselves is a huge part of honoring you. So God, be honored today. Be glorified. And Holy Spirit, teach us. We recognize you're the teacher here. And we surrender to your will. Lord, that you wouldn't just teach us so we could learn about forgiveness. But Lord, you would activate our hearts and motivate our hands and our feet and turn our mouths into instruments of forgiveness. And as we do so, Lord, we will praise you every single step of the way on this journey, that we can come as we are to you and you meet us and you change us as we walk with you. We love you. In the precious name of Jesus we pray. And everybody said, amen. Along with your Bible, I'd love for you to grab your outline that you should have been handed when you came in this morning and kind of track through a few things I want to share from this passage of Scripture. And there's some other Scriptures that are going to come into play here as well. But I want to give you that kind of big idea today right up front. It's this. Holding a grudge is like drinking poison and expecting somebody else to get sick. I know I've said that before. It didn't originate with me. When you talk about forgiveness, that I have to come coming back to that. That is what holding a grudge is really like. Like drinking poison and expecting somebody else to be affected by it. So let's look at forgiveness today. Forgiving others matters to God. That's where we want to start. Forgiving others matters to God. Your relationship with others matters to the God who created all of our relationships. I have three boys, and so one of the things that we have to learn in our home is to forgive on a regular basis. Now, when I only had one son, this is a few years back now, before Jericho and Nile came along, and Christian was a younger man, and not quite as tall, he's down here somewhere, he had a friend. And his friend was a neighbor, and they did a lot of stuff, and they played together quite often. And it turned out that every other day, this friend did something. He would tell Christian one thing and then do something else. Maybe you've had people in your life like that. He would make a promise to do one thing, but then he would do something else. And it happened several times over, and finally Christian came in, and he was like, "I'm done. We're not friends anymore." And I've heard that a bunch, you know. "We're not friends anymore." But he said, "I'm not giving him any more chances." Perhaps you've been there with somebody. Perhaps someone's been there with you. Just not giving them any more chances. How often do we treat others this way? Well, Peter comes to Jesus, and he asks him, how many times someone should be forgiven? How many times, when somebody hurts me, how many times do I need to forgive this offense? And Jesus gives him a little math problem, and then tells him this story about a servant who owes a huge debt to the king or the master in the story. And here's a few things Jesus says about forgiveness. He says, first of all, don't keep score. That's the first thing about forgiveness. We know that forgiving matters to God, and he's telling us, don't keep score. Peter says, should I forgive 7 times? Now, what did he ask? Why did he ask that specifically? Should I forgive 7 times? There's a couple of things to look at here, ways we can look at this. We need to remember that Peter and Jesus were ancient Jews. They lived in the first century. They were Jewish. And in their culture, how they looked at forgiveness and the law of God was this way. They listened to the rabbis and what the rabbis taught about it. And the rabbis taught that the law required you to forgive someone who offended you for the same thing 3 times. And they based that on Scripture. You can write this down and look it up later. Amos 2:6, Amos chapter 2, verse 6, and Job 33:29. Job 33:29. That's what the rabbis kind of base this teaching on. You must forgive if Charles comes and does, he hurts me in some way, he I don't know, takes my cowbell, I have to forgive him. He gives it back. Then he does it again. According to the law, I have to forgive him again, and he gives it back. And then he does it a third time. I have to forgive him and gives it back. Then he takes it again. I don't have to forgive him anymore. That I can have him put in prison like this story is. That was the law as they interpreted it. The rabbis taught them. But on the other hand, to this ancient culture, the number 7 represented not just always exactly 7, but a fullness, a completeness of it. And so when Jesus comes and he answers this question, and I almost wonder if Peter, with this question, has something specific in mind. Maybe his brother Andrew, or maybe James and John, or Judas, one of the other disciples, had done something and done it a few times over. I mean, they had just asked, who's the greatest in the kingdom? And all these other things are being asked amongst the disciples. And I wonder what was on Peter's, really, why he's asking, how many times do I have to forgive him? And Jesus says, 70 and 7. That's been interpreted as 77, like 70 plus 7. 70 and 7 has been interpreted like we read it today, 70 times 7, which is 490. And the point isn't that you have to forgive exactly 3 times. Or exactly 7 times, or exactly 77 times, or exactly 490 times. When Jesus says 70 times 7, he is saying to the complete, 70 times that, and you always do. You don't keep score. That's really what he's saying. You always forgive in the kingdom of God. No wonder about how Peter took that. He's telling me I got to forgive every time, plus he's giving me math work to do at the same time. I don't like this. It's not a magic number. How many times do you forgive? It's not a magic number. So don't keep score. And then Jesus says, set aside your anger. Don't keep score. And then what you have to do is you have to set aside your anger. And he tells this story. And in the story, the servant asks for patience. Please be patient with me. He says he pleads. Like he would to his master or his king anyway. Fall down on his knees and say, please be patient with me. and the word patience. This was originally written in Greek. And when it was written in Greek, the word that translates as patience is makrothumeo. Let me hear you say makrothumeo. Pretty good. Pretty good. That's a tough one. It's a compound word, makros and thumos. Makros and thumos. Makros meaning long or deep. Thumos meaning, really means passionate, to burn. It means to breathe heavy. So you can kind of interpret that however you want. But really, what it means, makrothumeo, it's a compound word, means to take a long, deep breath. Jesus says, when the man comes to the king, he says, please, please take a deep breath here. Take a long, deep breath. Patient. Set aside your anger. And if you know, you're like I am, sometimes you have to take a deep breath and count to 10. That's what he's saying here. What do you do with this anger? You take a deep breath. Set aside the anger and breathe in deeply. And then, the other thing that Jesus says about how we are to forgive and why it matters to God is because God is the one who actually shows us how to forgive. God is the one who shows us the way to forgive. And in the story, Jesus says the king forgives this advisor for money he had borrowed. And it really, in the original language, reads more like there was an embezzlement that took place here. That he had taken way, way, way too much money here. It says, it translates in some of you guys, millions of dollars is what I read today from the New Living Translation. And some of you guys are looking at a different translation. It says 10,000 talents, right? You know how much that is? A talent, this is from my studies, and I'm not an expert, but a talent was basically 15 years' wages. 15 years' wages for what was that? That was the measure of that, what a talent was. And he says 10,000 talents is what I was owed. The number of wages for 150,000 years. In other words, those who were hearing Jesus tell this story would hear him say this and go, inconceivable. You thought you had a lot of debt. This guy, it's 150,000 years worth of his wages is what he owes. Jesus, that's impossible to pay back. And that's the point. There is absolutely no way. The guy says, I promise you I'll pay every penny you can. And everybody hearing this story realizes there is no way he can possibly pay every penny he owes. It's not possible to pay this debt. And so they would hear this and expecting the next part of the story to be, so he was locked up and put away because he had a debt that could never be paid. But that's not how Jesus ends the story. What happens is the king, representing God, forgives the debt. He forgives the debt. It's gone. He doesn't say, okay, I'll give you more time, because it's a debt that can't be paid no matter how much time he's got. He says, I forgive it. It's as if you never owed me anything. And again, the people hearing this story, inconceivable. How we treat others matters to God. In the story, Jesus says that this servant then had a lack of patience. He didn't take a deep breath when it came to his relationship with his fellow servant. And he held against him what was owed. Oh, it was owed. There was no dispute that this other servant owed him thousands of dollars, it says. There's no dispute he owed it, but he wasn't patient. He didn't show the same patience. He didn't show the same pity or the same compassion or the same forgiveness that the master had shown him. And it says that the king was so angry about this. It was more about his lack of makrothumeo, that he had received makrothumeo and he didn't extend it to his brother. He's seemingly here more angry than he was about the original debt. How dare you receive the grace and the forgiveness and the complete clean slate and then not extend that same to your brother? He expects that we treat others the same way. Those who are forgiven must forgive. And Colossians 3:13 says, you must make allowance for each other's faults and forgive the person who offends you. Remember, the Lord forgave you, so you must forgive others. We're not allowed to skip over that scripture if we're saying, I'm a follower of Christ. Now, if we're saying, you know, I'm a fan of Jesus, then you kind of skip over and pick the points you like and all that because you like Jesus and you like that. But if you're a follower of Christ, not only are you not allowed to skip over it, you're also not to take that and use it as a weapon, because I've actually heard that. Well, you know, you have to forgive me because the Bible says so. If I do something to you, going, I can say, Colossians 3:13 says, you have to forgive me any person that offends you. So I'm going to offend you, and you have to forgive me, because Colossians 3:13 says, you know what? You don't have the Holy Spirit in you. You got the devil in you. You're taking Scripture and you're using it the absolute reverse direction. It's not giving life and inspiration, but it's tearing down and destroying. So let's be those who forgive, and let's use the Scripture appropriately. Jesus says, don't keep score. Set aside your anger. Take a deep breath. And God forgives us an inconceivably huge debt. That's the bottom line. Forgiveness matters to God. And forgive others the same way He's forgiven you. But even understanding this, it's like, okay, forgiveness matters to God. But again, why? Why do I have to forgive so much? Well, let's continue and look at this. That forgiveness also matters to myself. Me. You can put the word me or myself in the next blank if you're filling in the blanks. Forgiveness matters to God, and forgiving others matters to myself. A number of years ago, this was before I lived in Arkansas and cheered for a team that fumbled the ball in the last minute of the game. And golly, I'm with you guys. You guys know I'm from Louisiana and I'm an LSU Tiger, but I cheer for the Razorbacks every game of the year but that one when they play LSU. And last night I was heartbroken. I was ready to come to. I was even like, I'm going to wear my Arkansas shirt to church tomorrow. And I was like, golly, I kind of lost it. But way before I came to Arkansas, that was off the point. When I came to Arkansas, I experienced something, and I experienced it in church. And that was maybe what's the most difficult thing for some people is they experience gossip, they experience being stabbed in the back, they experience those kind of things in church. I'm probably not telling you something you don't already know, but it happened to me. It happened to me that there was somebody told somebody else something, and then they told somebody else something, and the next thing you know, there is this whole bunch of people who have made this huge grand assumption and absolutely zero truth to it. And it hurt. It hurt bad. It hurt really bad. I was employed of the church. I was called of God and employed of the church as an associate pastor, and I wanted to have nothing else to do with them. God brought healing, though. God brings healing. But I've experienced that. And I've experienced the fact that forgiving them, even though to this day, and I have a good relationship with at least one of these folks right now, but they've never asked for forgiveness. They never said, I'm sorry. And, Steve, how do you handle that? Because I forgave them a long time ago, realizing I can't wait till they say I'm sorry to forgive them. If they ever do, man, that's going to be... I say, you know what? That's all gone. It's already forgiven. But thank you. Thank you for saying you're sorry. That absolutely means the world to me. But yes, you've been forgiven for that. That's what we have to do, is forgive. Maybe even if they never said or even recognized they were at fault. That's what true forgiveness is. And that matters to me, and there's some reasons why it matters to us. Because it does. The reasons to forgive, and I think one of the number one reasons, is that forgiveness gives us personal peace. Forgiveness gives us personal peace, inner peace, peace of mind, and peace in our hearts. And I want that. I want peace in my life. And I know that we want peace in our life. I mean, who wakes up in the morning and I want to be bitter today? I've met some people who I think that's what they do. They wake up and say, I'm going to be bitter today. But I don't think they actually do. I don't think they actually do. I think we all want to have peace in our life. But when I refuse to forgive somebody, you know what? I carry a bitter attitude because I'm carrying unforgiveness. That's what it is. That's what a grudge is. It's a bitter attitude. And when I carry that, I suffer more than they do. I suffer far more than they do. The truth is, when you refuse to forgive someone, they own you. They do. Because, think about it. When you have this broken relationship, or maybe the refusal to forgive somebody, and you're holding on to that, you may choose where to go and not to go because they're there. I've had some folks that tell me, you know what, Pastor? I'm not coming back to that church because so-and-so still goes there. About this church, yeah. Well, you know what? You need to grow up. You need to forgive, and you need to get yourself right with Christ before everything else and get some personal peace about this, because you're letting them own you. And the reason we don't want to forgive them is because they did hurt us. And ultimately, we really want them to hurt the same way we hurt. That's really what it's about. We really think, if I hold this grudge, it's going to hurt them the way they hurt me. And experiences show me that ain't true. not true. We hang on to bitterness, and it will hurt us far more than it would ever hurt them. But forgiving them leads to peace in my life, because bitterness is heavy. Carrying a grudge, it's heavy. Forgiveness, and you just drop it, and you have freedom. Colossians 3:15 says, "Let the peace that Christ gives control your thinking. Because you were called together in one body to have peace, always be thankful." Man, how do you live in this place where you can forgive? Always be thankful. Start there. And remember, let the peace that Christ gives you control your thinking. Reason number two why we should forgive is, yes, there's personal peace, but also this reminder that no one is perfect. Nobody's perfect. Imagine if I had us line up this morning. Let's say, okay, over here on this side, we're going to put everybody who has never... Actually, we could just move seats. So everybody who has never hurt anybody, if you've never offended anybody, you've never wronged anybody, even on accident, you've never offended anybody or hurt anybody, come over here. If you've never done it. And everybody else, you got to come over here with me, because this is where I got to be. Because I have hurt people, offended people. Yes, sometimes on accident, and I'll admit it, there have been times in my life I did it on purpose, way before Christ. You would probably be with me on the not perfect side. We need forgiveness at some point. All of us. All of us at some point need forgiveness from others. How can we hold back from someone what we ourselves know that we would love to receive? How can we hold back the compassion, the love, the forgiveness? And man, if I've hurt somebody, I want to be forgiven of that. Don't hold on to that. I want us to have a right relationship. So if you've hurt me, then I want to be able to give that to you too. 1 John 1:10 says, "If we've claimed we've not sinned, we're calling God a liar and showing that His Word has no place in our hearts." We all need forgiveness at some point. All of us. And another reason to forgive is that, well, Jesus paid it all. Forgive because Jesus paid it all. I know that's the churchy answer. Guess where we are? Church! Jesus paid it all. You remember one of the things when Jesus was on the cross? He said a lot of things on the cross. And you may or may not be familiar with the story of the crucifixion and the story of what we call the Easter story. But Jesus is on the cross. And among the many things He says is, "It is finished." He didn't say it like that except in the movies because He didn't speak English. The word He said was tetelestai. Tetelestai, which translates "it is finished." It is accomplished. It is fulfilled. It's a term that comes from the world of commerce. It means it's paid in full. He said, "It is paid in full." Not part of it, not a little bit, not like, you know what, I'll pay this part, God. But Father, they'll have a little bit more to pay. He said, "All, it is complete." Our salvation, our forgiveness, our restoration to God is complete in Christ Jesus. And because He paid it all, He tells us that we must forgive others. Because we're covered. It's been paid. Our debt has been paid. 1 John 1:9 says, "If we confess our sins, He is faithful and righteous to forgive our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness." And I don't know where you are this morning, but I'm telling you this. If you're in this place where you're like, "Man, I am not there. I am not. I can't sing that song, 'I'm forgiven, I am free,' because I'm not forgiven. I know I'm not." He says right here, "If we confess our sins, He is faithful and righteous to forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness." And if you need that, don't leave here today without receiving that. That is the gospel, which means good news. So forgiving others matters to God. Forgiving others matters to myself. And forgiving others, actually, it matters to others. It really does. It matters to others. Watch this short video. it possible that part of our problem, part of our inability to forgive others, is that we just simply don't know how? I mean, maybe that's a part of it. Maybe you struggle like I have at times in my life, and I look at the person in the mirror and struggle with even forgiving myself for some things. And it really, we use this phrase, kind of a cliche, it's easier to forgive others than forgive yourself. But really, until you learn to forgive yourself, you really can't truly learn how to forgive others. So perhaps we need to start there. Forgiving others matters to others. First of all, how do you forgive? You have to choose to. You have to make a choice. You have to make a decision to forgive. If I wait until I feel like forgiving, it's probably not going to happen. Till I feel about it. Emotional wounds don't heal themselves. They say time heals all wounds. No, forgiveness heals wounds. First, we have to make a decision to forgive them. Then, the feelings can follow. We can't wait until the pain is gone to forgive. Sometimes we have to forgive even though the pain's going to continue for a while. So choose to forgive. Next, you have to say it. You have to say it. Out loud, I would say. That works best for me. I forgive you. And maybe you're not in a place where you can say to that person, I forgive you to them. But say it out loud. At least say it to yourself. I'm not going to hold this grudge against him or her anymore. And say their name. I forgive you. Now don't say it out, where everybody else is around. And I would say, if they haven't said I'm sorry and asked for forgiveness, you might not even want to say it to them at that point. Because that just kind of stirs the pot sometimes. Somebody has told me before, I forgive you. I had no idea it even hurt them. Luckily for them, I realized I did at that point. And I said, oh, I'm sorry. They already forgave me. But we need to say it and say it out loud. There's no point in stirring the pot, though. But here's to say, if I can't say I forgive you, then you haven't forgiven. You have to make a choice to forgive, and then you have to be able to say it. I'm sorry. I forgive you. And then, let it go. Let it go. The cold never bothered me anyway. Let it go. Guys, I've done some embarrassing things. I've done some hurtful things. I've done stupid things in my life. And I don't have to tell you what they all are, because I don't want to know what all yours are either, because you've done the same. You've done embarrassing and stupid and dumb things. We all have. And you know what? Of all those things I've done and the things I've done that really, I know, hurt God because I went way outside of His will for my life, He's forgiven me. Of all those things, whether they were annoying or dumb or stupid or sinful, He's forgiven me. He has let it go. And the same way He expects me to forgive others, that same way. And as we let it go, as we choose to let go, as we say the words and actually let it go, we have to realize that we may have to forgive repeatedly. That's part of life. It's part of relationships, to forgive repeatedly. I may have to forgive someone the same offense more than once. And maybe not even be because they do the same thing to me over and over. That's a different thing. We'll talk about that in just a second. But they've done one thing, and I said, I forgive you. And the next morning I wake up and I'm still mad about it. You know what I got to do? Forgive again. And the next morning I wake up, they didn't do it again, but I'm still mad about it. I need to forgive again. So it isn't necessarily I need to forgive repeatedly because the offense needs forgiven multiple times. I need to set aside my anger multiple times and be able to let it go. And then here's the one more thing. Forgiveness is not the same as trust. We need to get that. That's the reality of this. Forgiveness is not the same as trust. Forgive and forget isn't necessarily true. Because deep hurt is there. Deep hurt is real. And you don't necessarily forget deep hurt. Forgiveness is choosing to set that aside. Forgiveness is a choice. Forgiveness is a gift. Rachel does something to hurt me, and I forgive her. It's like giving her the gift of forgiveness. But she's going to have to earn the trust back. See, trust has to be earned, while forgiveness is a gift. Trust is not a gift. And I've had a few times of counseling folks in their marriages and in relationships with sometimes parents and kids. And like, you know what? You messed up. They said they've forgiven you. Now you're saying they don't act like they trust you anymore? Dude, you got to earn it back. You can't expect to just be trusted the way you were before because you broke a trust. Forgiveness is granted, not earned. But trust is granted, and it can't be earned. Colossians 3:13, remember what it says. As it says, to forgive one another for the offenses against us. And it says, forgive as the Lord forgave you. And all these things. Forgive as the Lord forgave you. Completely, 100% gone. Forgiven. Is there someone in your life you need to forgive? I want you to do this. I want everybody to do this, whether or not you have somebody you need to forgive. I want you to take your fist, and I want you to ball it up real tight. Go ahead. Now, your first instinct may be, if you really have somebody you're holding something against, say, okay, Pastor Steve is going to tell me to imagine their face. I want you to. I want you to imagine their face, but not like you're going to punch them. And what you're clutching right now isn't a fist ready to punch him, but it's a lack of forgiveness. Clench that fist as tight as you can. You're clutching onto something. You're holding on to that unforgiveness. And what God is wanting us to do, every one of us to do right now, is completely let that go and relax that hand. That's just symbolically what He's done for us and what He wants us to do for one another. And as we do that, I want you to pray. God, thank you for beginning this restoration process. And that my relationship with this person may never, ever be what it was. But thank you for helping me forgive them. Help me to walk in that forgiveness. Thank you for forgiving me. Thank Him for the forgiveness He's provided through Jesus. Commit your decision to forgive. Commit it to God. Come to Him in prayer. Lord, we love you. Thank you for meeting us, for bringing us together. Thank you for your forgiveness. May we walk in it. In Jesus' name, amen. Grace and peace be with you.